listen to the word that you're going to present to us today so that we may take you with us throughout our week, wherever we may go. And as we encounter those that do not yet know you, that we may present just a little bit of you to them to where they want to know more about you. Lord, we just pray as we go throughout this service that first and foremost, we put you first. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to First Baptist Church here in Lewisburg, Tennessee. All those that are members, you're expected to be here. And then all those that are visiting, we thank you for taking your time to be here. If you'll look on the pew in front of you, there's a little tab there. If you'll fill that out, if there's any prayer concerns you may have, just drop that in the offering plate as it comes by. And if you're wondering, it's a little bit cool in here this morning, but don't worry, we paid the bill. But that's all part of the game here. We want you to get a little bit closer to one another. So if you're on the wings and you're a little cold, just get to the middle and y'all can all scrunch up. So we'd like to welcome those that are watching us on the internet, as you may say now. And if you need a ride, if you want to visit with us and you need a ride, we have a bus ministry. If you'll just call the church office at 359-4077. And at this time, we'll stand up, we'll greet one another. Now, we haven't done it in a while, but you may see a little bit of kissing going on. And we like to greet each other with a holy kiss, and these men on the front row take that seriously. So don't think nothing about it. So if you'll stand and greet each other.
Thank you. have the candles. It's kind of sad, but it's a new beginning. Now I want you guys to look. I brought something this morning. It's a light bulb. I actually think this one might be shot, so it might not be very good. It makes a noise, but this probably doesn't look like the light bulbs you guys are used to seeing, does it? The ones y'all have now are all swirly and pretty and fancy. This isn't what they call now an old-timey light bulb. But it still serves a purpose. If it's not shot, it still provides light. Light's very important for us. Helps us find our way. Did you notice we sang a song earlier about Shine Your Light on Me? Yeah, I thought that was really neat. I was really happy that we sang that song today. Because today I want to talk to you about another light that was in the sky years and years ago. And you've probably heard about this light. It was the star. It was the star that led the wise men to find baby Jesus. And we find that story in Matthew chapter 2. And it tells how they were told to follow this star, and they had heard that it would take them to the new king. They didn't know what to expect. They weren't Jewish, and they weren't quite sure what was going on. But they did what they were told. And it says, after they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star that they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. And they came to the child, and they bowed down, and they gave him gifts. And having been warned, they didn't go back to the king who had offered them a reward if they would show him where this child was. Now, that star shone so brightly, and it carried them right where they needed to go. It showed them the way in the darkness. It led them to something. Now, today, we think of Jesus Christ as that star. He lights our way. Now, you know, if it gets dark outside and you don't have a light bulb, you can always light a candle or a lantern or something, right? Or you could have a flashlight or your phone. Everybody has a flashlight on their phone now, right? And you'll have light to show you the way. But sometimes that kind of light just won't show you your way. There are times in your life you're going to get in a dark place that this kind of light won't help. You're going to need a light that comes from somewhere else. You're going to need the light of Jesus Christ to show you the way. You're going to need him to shine his light on you, to give you a good direction and show you what's in your future and what you need to be doing. So when you think of lights, we have these here, we have the sun, we have candles, we have our phones. When you think of those kind of lights, don't forget there's one light that will never go out. It'll never burn out like this one. It'll always be there. All you have to do is accept it into your heart and ask Jesus Christ to show you the way with his light. Okay? Can you guys remember that? All right, let's say our prayers this morning. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we just praise you for sending the light into this world to watch over us and guide us and direct us, Lord. I just hope that each and every person that can hear my voice right now will accept that light and follow that light and allow it to lead them in the right path, Lord. I ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen.
Our scripture reading today is taken from Acts chapter 2. Verses 40 through 47, which is page 926 in your pew Bible. And with many other words he bore witness, and continued to exhort them, saying, Save yourselves from this crooked generation. So those who received his word were baptized, and they were added the day about 3,000 souls. And they devoted themselves to the apostles, teaching, and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing them in proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts.
praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number, day by day, those who were being saved. May the Lord bless the reading and hearing of his word.
Let us join together to pray. We are grateful, we're glad to gather in your presence, to magnify the name of Jesus, to lift up the one who loved us and gave himself for us. We thank you for the wonder of the gospel, that you died for our sins, were buried and raised on the third day, and appeared alive for many days, and you ascended into heaven with the promise that you will return. You sent your Holy Spirit, we have experienced goodness and grace ever since. We thank you for your presence and your power and your purpose. We thank you at the beginning of this new year that we thank you that you will continue working in our midst as you have in the past, that you are present with us here and now. We pray that your continued blessing will be upon your people as we gather in your presence to worship your name. In the name of Jesus we pray. And all God's people said.
Come to that time in our worship that we want to give back just a portion of what God's blessed us with. And if you'll take a look, Lottie Moon goal was $5,049. That's just a dollar more than what we give last year. And right now we've given $4,988. So just remember that as you're giving today. If you will, please bow. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for what you've already blessed us with. We've come to that time in our worship that we can give back just a portion of what you've already given us. We pray that you'll use this according to your will. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Would you open a Bible to Acts chapter 2, make your way to verse 40. I would love for you to be able to follow along today as I share with you God's Word. And we're going to stay right there in Acts chapter 2, so just open your Bible and be ready, and I'll refer to some verses along the way. I looked at some pictures of some of the massive stones that make up the foundations and the walls of the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. And never been there, so I don't have a direct experience of it, but I saw pictures in relation to some people, and some of those stones are huge. And I read that some of them weigh as much as 160,000 pounds, and I wonder, how in the world did they move those things to get them into place? And just overwhelmed with how impressive that is, and thought about what the disciples experienced as they left with Jesus to cross over into the Mount of Olives, and they could look at the Temple Mount and they could see the stones, and they were overwhelmed with that. And Jesus said, all these stones are going to be removed. And it's an amazing, amazing kind of thing. Those foundation stones are still there and impressive just because of their bulk and their size. They're just amazingly impressive. Jesus concluded the Sermon on the Mount with a parable. He talked about two men who built a home, built homes for themselves. And he said, one guy dug down to the bedrock and he built his house on the rock, and the other guy didn't do that. He built his house on the sand. And so Jesus said, you know what happens when you build a home? The rains come and the winds blow and the floods will rise up, and what happens to the house? Well, the one that was founded on the rock survived the storm. The one that was on the sand did not. So foundations are very, very important for any kind of a building project. Every building project depends upon the substantial character of the foundation upon which it's built. And this is especially true when it comes to building a spiritual house, like your life, or a home, or a church. The foundations are so important. What you build on is so very important. Now, there is one builder and only one foundation, and he is Jesus. The whole church and everything that we're about here is founded on the person and the work of Jesus and nothing else. We are gathering together and we're building on that one foundation. We're adding other foundational stones to make up this thing that we call the church. And so I want to use a simple acrostic this morning to help you to see the character of the church. The acrostic WIFE, W-I-F-E, describes foundations for a fruitful church. And you see that in the passage of Scripture. Let's begin. I mean, we'll just jump right in here. W, the first foundational stone is worship. Look at verse 42. Scripture says that those 3,000 who responded to the invitation on that Pentecost Sunday were devoting themselves to the breaking of bread and the prayers, and to the prayers. Now, they were not casual about this. They were engaged in this thing that we call worship. Verse 43 says, every soul was becoming overwhelmed with awe. And when you read it in the original language, you discover the word fear there, and you discover throughout the Bible that a right response to the reality and the person of God has to do with this kind of reverential fear, a kind of healthy respect for who God is because of what God has done. Well, just in himself, he is worthy of praise, and he is awful, if you will. He is a scary being. He summons the best response from us in that way. And these disciples, as they were experiencing worship, were being filled with, overwhelmed with this sense of awe about who God is. Verse 47 says, they were praising God and having favor with all the people. So as they rejoiced in what God had done for them, they were sharing it, but just by their rejoicing, just by their celebrating, just by their praising God. And people around them were experiencing kind of the overflow of the grace that they had already experienced. So that's what was happening when these first 3,000 disciples were devoting themselves to prayer. By the way, let me catch myself before. The translation I read says they devoted themselves, and when we read it in English, it sounds like they made a commitment. They did it, and that's all, you know. But the text in the original reads, they were devoting themselves, so it was an ongoing activity for them. It didn't just happen once. We tend to think about our conversion experience as something that happened way back yonder. And for most of us, there was a beginning point in our relationship with Jesus Christ. But it is an ongoing experience. So our faith didn't just happen. Our repentance didn't just take place. It is continuing in the living of our lives. So that's what they were doing when they were gathering to worship. On May 27, 2009... the world's largest worship venue was opened in Arlington, Texas. No, not the guy you're thinking of. 30,000 parking places. Imagine that. A gigantic center. I mean, a huge high-definition television covering the center of this, you know, hung from the ceiling of this place, and 160 by 72 feet. That's a huge, huge thing here. State-of-the-art sound system, everything high-tech, absolutely primo for a worship center. Now, it's near perfect place to sing and shout and gather together and cry and clap and pray and maybe with a crowd that's big enough to fill that place, you know, you could summon a measure of energy that might be just delightful just to experience by being there with a large group of people. Now, to what church does this massive place belong to? Tony Evans asked, to the Baptist, to the Charismatics? And he says, well, they're the only ones with coin enough to do that. Well, he hadn't been to First Baptist, has he? Who else has $1.3 billion that it cost to build that thing? Well, Jerry Jones, the owner of the Dallas Cowboys, has that kind of money. All year long, whether for a football game, a concert, motocross, or a tractor pull. Can you tractor pull? That sounds like a lot of fun. People come together, and the only reason that they come together is to rejoice. They come there to celebrate, to cheer their team, to enjoy the moment, to be happy. And all those are aspects of what worship is really meant to be by God. Now, when you stop and read through the scriptures and discover places that talk about worship, it is not the sour, dour, down experience that most of us like to make it. It's meant to be a joyful and happy kind of an experience. And that's what it was in the early church. Those first 3,000 disciples engaged in a worship that left them feeling really, really happy. The first 3,000 disciples were ready to worship any time, any place, any day of the week. Their hearts were open and receptive to the Lord when they came together. Their hearts were yielded to the Lord, which is the next step that we all must take. But their hearts were filling with faith. No one of them had absolute, complete, perfect faith. They're just like you. They were just like you and I are. They're growing in their experience of who God is and in their ability to believe and trust in Him, but they're not there yet. They're not completely there yet. They don't have an absolute, unshakable faith. That's what makes this thing so worthwhile, because we have opportunity to grow. Now, we can learn from those first 3,000 disciples that authentic worship is Jesus-centered and not man-centered. Thank you. That needs to be punctuated, don't you agree? That real worship is not people-centered. It is not focused on who I am or what I want or the style that I prefer or the music that I choose. It is focused on who Jesus is. Everything about the life of the church is founded on who Jesus is, on what He does, on what He is. Authentic worship celebrates what Jesus did for us. And we can look back and we can remember the cross and we can understand some of the horror of the cross and some of the suffering of what the cross was. We can learn all kinds of detail about the physical harm that came to Jesus as He died on that cross. But it doesn't even begin to capture the essence of what that cross was all about. We know what Jesus did for us. We know what Jesus is doing for us now. He's in the process. I think we need to learn to live our faith in the present tense, don't you? Because there's things that Jesus is going to do for us. We celebrate what He's going to do for us. But we live in the now. And somewhere between what Jesus did for us and what He's going to do for us, He's still doing something with our lives. And the thing that we need to do is to focus on what He is doing with us now. And there's some continuity and consistency between what He already did, what He is going to do, with what He's doing right now. And this becomes the subject of our worship. This becomes the reality of our worship now. What Jesus is up to, what Jesus is doing right now. Authentic worship happens when we come together to acknowledge and appreciate what Jesus has done, is doing, and will do. And I like those words, acknowledge and appreciate. One of the big problems that the book of Romans points out to us, Paul said, one of the big problems that people have, all of us have, is that we tend not to acknowledge who God is and not to give thanks for his character and for what he's about. And that starts us on a downward spiral that the book of Romans calls human depravity, that describes human depravity. So if we come to the place where we will acknowledge and appreciate what Jesus is doing in the here and now, in the present tense, we'll make a good direction. We'll take good steps in a good direction. When we pray, we go before a throne of grace. It's approached always with a lowly reverence, with an honor about it. There's something wonderful about being able to pray. It's an honor bestowed upon us, but it's because of the honor of the one that we're addressing when we pray. It's a throne that should be approached with devout joyfulness and complete submission in our lives. And I read from Charles Haddon Spurgeon, great preacher from another generation. He said, we should approach prayer with enlarged expectation. Let me sort of illustrate what he means by that. Alexander the Great sent a word to one of his soldiers, and he said, ask whatever you want. Basically, that's all he said. He didn't say it could be as big as you want or as small as you want, just whatever you need, what do you want? Ask for it. And so, I'm not there yet. Okay. Ask for whatever it is you want. And this soldier went to the treasurer, and he asked for such a big thing that the treasurer was upset by this big request that the guy made. And he said, he refused to pay it. He said, you've asked for way too much. You're not worthy of what you've asked. Which is always true when we pray, right? We're not worthy of what we get from God, are we? Nobody earns anything from God, right? So the treasurer goes to Alexander himself, and he says, this soldier asked for something so big, and I refuse to pay it. What do you want me to do about this soldier? And Alexander responded to the treasurer, he knows how great Alexander is, and he has asked from a king. Let him have what he requested. When we go before the Lord Jesus Christ, before the throne of grace, we're going before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the one who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. We're going to the one who created everything that is. There is nothing outside of his touch. He owns it all. And when we go before him, when we ask for our needs, can we be encouraged to believe that asking big honors God? Asking big can honor God. I think we need to learn how to do that. I read this interesting thing. One Sunday morning at a small southern church, the new pastor called on one of the older deacons to pray. So everybody bowed their heads and closed their eyes to get ready for prayer the way that we do. And the old deacon said, Lord, I hate buttermilk. Pastor opened his eyes and said, what's going on here? Closed his eyes, and the old deacon continued, Lord, I hate lard. When the pastor opened his eyes, he saw several folk looking in the direction of the old deacon. They all went along with it. Lord, I ain't too crazy about plain flour. But after you mix them all together and bake them in a hot oven, I just love biscuits. Now, that'd been a neat prayer if it just stopped right there, wouldn't it? But the old deacon continued, Lord, help us to realize when life gets hard, when things come up that we don't like, whenever we don't understand what you're doing, help us understand we need to wait and see what you're making. After you get through mixing and baking, it'll probably be something even better than biscuits. Amen. Now that's prayer. Amen. Second foundational stone. Now I'm ready for you. Instruction. The second foundational stone is instruction. Verse 42, they were devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. They welcomed instruction. They were learning how to live the Christian life as the apostles explained the meaning of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. How it impacted life and how it would shape the life of the person who accepted what Jesus did for them. So it would make a difference in their lives, so they submitted themselves to the instruction that the apostles were given. A salesman was stuck on the interstate. We had this experience when we moved to New Orleans. The day we left and the day we moved in to New Orleans, we got stuck on the interstate. And there's on the interstate, there's no way to get off because there's just water all around you there. We were stuck on there. And this happened to a pastor, a salesman. And he's stuck on the highway, and what we did was, you know, we turned the car engine off and we got out of the car and we walked around and waited, you know, because there's no indication we're going to get loose from there. Well, this salesman got bored and he had nothing else to do. So he pulled from his glove box the manual for his car. Got to be bored if you're going to read that thing, right? He started reading the thing and he discovered a couple of things about his car. He'd been driving it for 3 years already, and when he bought the car, he went there and he saw the steering wheel and he saw where, you know, the ignition switch and the accelerator and the brake pedal. So he knew how to drive this thing, and he'd been driving it for 3 years, but as he read, he discovered that his car could remember different drivers, and when different drivers got in the seat, the seat would automatically adjust for the driver. Isn't that amazing? He said, I didn't know that. And he said, there's a wiper in the back. So when the weather is really, really bad, I could have turned the wiper on, and I could see out the back. I didn't know that. And he read further, and he said, you know, it can defog the outside mirrors. I didn't know that. And then he was surprised most of all when he read, it could be started from inside the house. I didn't know that. Which is exactly the response of many Christian people in the United States of America today who did not know what the Bible said about this life. Isn't that amazing? I didn't know that. In Luke chapter 24, Jesus was walking and talking with a couple of disciples right after the resurrection had occurred, but these two disciples had not seen the risen Jesus, at least as far as they knew, and they were walking and talking and dialoguing about the things that happened in Jerusalem, and Jesus joined them and got involved in the conversation, and then Jesus kind of rebuked them and said, didn't you know that this stuff should have happened? That what you're talking about happening to Jesus and you don't understand, it's all over the scriptures. And he began talking to them about the scriptures. And they went farther along the way and they finally got to their destination. And Jesus acted as if he was going to go on. But they said, no, it's late. Why don't you come and stay with us? And when Jesus broke the bread and gave thanks, it reminded them of who he was. And they saw him for who he was. And then Jesus parted from them. And they looked at each other, and there they said, had no idea. But he said, didn't our hearts burn as he explained the scriptures to us? Because that's what Jesus did. He showed them from the Old Testament what the scriptures are about. In fact, the end of Luke's gospel, verses 44 through 47, Luke 24, tells us, he said, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Now, the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms, those are the three major divisions of what the Old Testament is, okay? This is our Old Testament that Jesus is talking about. And Jesus is saying that everything written about him in those three divisions of the Old Testament, that Jesus is all over the Old Testament, okay? That's the point he wanted to make. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. Does that astound you? He not only explained that he could be found throughout the Old Testament, he gave them understanding. So that they could see for themselves the truth about him in the Old Testament. And then he interpreted in a general sort of way what all that meant. He said to them, thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem, beginning from Jerusalem. So what he said, he proclaimed the gospel from the Old Testament, references to who he is and what happened in his life. Which says something about the formation of the church as being a people formed by the Word. That's what we are. That's our beginning. Not with any human movement, but with a declaration from God that has its expression in the Word. Having shared those thoughts with you, back in Acts chapter 2, the early part of the book, you'll discover that when the Holy Spirit came upon the disciples, and it was an astounding and a mysterious kind of an event, and the people were beholding something that just freaked them out, basically. Peter stood to explain to them what had happened when they were filled with the Spirit. And the way that Peter explained it to them was to go to the Scriptures, to interpret what was happening in their life from the Scriptures, the Old Testament, citing Joel and some of the Psalms and referring to David the king and things like that. In this sermon that Peter delivered, he went back to the Scriptures to explain what was happening in the midst of life right then. Now, does that tell you how important Scripture is to the development of your life and your faith? It should. I would to God that we would all become the students of Scripture that we could be. I don't want you to leave that job to me or to your Sunday school teacher. You should get in the Word. Get up to your neck in the Bible. Learn what's there. Discover what God has said and how he has worked in the past and how he's promised to work in the future, and begin to interpret your life and your experiences now by what you discover in the Word. Don't wait for me or for the Sunday school teacher to explain it to you. Get it for yourself. You have more access to a Bible than any other generation that has ever walked the face of the earth. That first generation of Christians, those first 3,000, all they had was an Old Testament scripture and the authenticating preaching and work of the apostles. That's all they had. But from the work that they did and the preaching that they did to begin with has come our New Testament, and we have substantially what they taught and what they preached, that first generation. So you'll never hear Jesus speak. You'll never hear Peter speak. But you have access to what they preached in the Bible that you can hold in your hand. It's time we got into the Word and let the Word interpret our life for us. There's a third foundational stone. It's fellowship. And there's a fourth foundational stone, it's expression. You'll discover that in verse 42, they were devoting themselves to the fellowship. Verse 44, all the believers were together and they had everything common. That is, there was a strong sense of togetherness about them. They were bound to a common Lord. They were sharing a common kind of an experience. Verse 46 says they were attending the temple together. They were sharing meals together in their homes. They were feeling glad and generous, is what they said, in their hearts. They were a happy community. Their fellowship was one of great joy. Jesus' purpose, that joy would abound in the church. You know that? And yet, what abounds? Let's move on. The fourth foundational stone is expression. Verse 45 says, they shared their goods with others. Verse 47, the Lord was adding to them those who were being saved day by day. See, when we've believed the gospel and we've entered into the life created by that gospel, and we've begun to live it, we're going to be brought together. There's no way we cannot be together. We're going to have a fellowship that is deep and profound, that in some sense is even stronger than blood kin kind of relationship. And there's going to be an expression to this faith that'll sort of spill over to the world around us. And the Lord will add those who should be saved. That's quite a picture of the church, isn't it? Amen? Now, and it's accessible to us. It's what we can do right here, beginning right now, if we'll just see that picture and set aside all of our other images of what we think the church ought to be. Let's put aside the business model, the military model. Let's put aside all the other models. Let's see this template worked out here, where we come together in worship, for instruction, for fellowship, and for expression to the glory of God. Amen. Let's bow. Our Father, we thank you for this picture of what your church was meant to be, what you purposed for us in this life. We pray, our Father, that you help us even now to make adjustments in our lives so that we adapt to you and not cause you to adapt to us, so that we begin to conform and participate in this plan for your people. And I pray for one who does not yet know Jesus as Savior and Lord to come to faith in him today by your grace and through your mercy and as your Spirit moves in the heart of that one. To your glory and praise, together we pray in the name of Jesus. Let's stand together. All the way my Savior leads me. Some of you, He is calling to Himself for the very first time. You've been on the edge of relationship with Him. You know about it, but you've never entered fully into it. I want to encourage